Hello everyone, this is Dr. Kishore Kumar. Today I would like to discuss on glyoxylate cycle. If you see the vertebrates cannot operate this cycle because of the limitation of two enzymes. So not vertebrates mean, which is with the example of humans also. In humans, we cannot convert the fats to the glucose. So this is like an best example for a gluconeogenesis. Here exactly the fat molecule which is stored in the plants, even certain microorganisms, that is to be converting into the glucose molecules. This is an anabolic cycle where exactly it can be involved for the synthesis of new glucose molecule from the lipids or acetates of the lipids. So we will start the class. In this particular session, I am going to discuss about the basic introductory points, where I'll give you a few basics which is related with the glyoxylate cycle, and I also discuss about the glyoxysomes. Glyoxysomes, these are the membrane bound organelles which will be involved for the operation of this glyoxylate cycle. So that's what the name is, glyoxylate, because that can be operated or that can be present in the glyoxysomes particular pathway. And after that, I'll also discuss about the actually what are the different steps that are involved in glyoxylate cycle and what are the enzymes which are important and what are the regulators and inhibitors. That particular part also I will discuss in the glyoxylate cycle, under glyoxylate cycle. And if you see this glyoxylate cycle, most of the cases these reactions will be similar to the citric acid cycle, except a few variations. So here the regulation part, which is important with respect to the Krebs cycle. So once the Krebs cycle is activated, glyoxylate cycle has to be shut down. If the glyoxylate cycle is to be activated, the Krebs cycle has to be shut down. So how these two pathways is regulating to each other, that part also I am going to discuss here. And finally, I'll try to give you a few recent information which is related with the glyoxylate cycle. So if you see the glyoxylate cycle, definitely, which is, as I explained, the importance of glyoxylate cycle is to be just, you can see here, in simple words, we can define the cycle is, that is, convert fat into carbohydrates. It's clear? So we want to define the glyoxylate cycle. We can define it as follows. The convert of fat molecule into carbohydrates, we call glyoxylate cycle. And the discovery of this glyoxylate cycle has done by two scientists, Karenberg and Krebs, when they are working in Pseudomonas. Pseudomonas is a bacteria. When they are working with the sucrose-related pathway with the radio-labeled isotope techniques, then they find out that this is a specialized pathway that can be present in Pseudomonas. And then later that it can be even investigated in many investigated in plants and many microorganisms. So if you take plants, especially, this is not to be compulsory that it can be present all the stages of plant, but initial stage, that is at the germination stage, at the seedling stage, this glyoxylate cycle is to be operated, or this particular glyoxysomes, where exactly this pathway is activated, that can be there at the time bound. And if you take many microorganisms, because certain microorganisms like E. coli and yeast, for their carbon source, it can depend on acetate. So the acetate or acetic acid, the acetate and acetic acid, which will act as a carbon source for many different kind of the microorganisms where this particular pathway is operating. Example I have given is E. coli and yeast. And if you see this, as I explained, this is an anabolic variant of citric acid cycle. That we should understand. What do you mean by anabolic variant? So anabolism, catabolism, these are the two words which we will frequently use. If anabolism, catabolism, and amphibolic reactions, if you have any doubt, you please go back to my initial videos and you can better understand about this terminology. So this glyoxylate cycle is called as, which is an anabolic variant of citric acid cycle. How it is to be anabolic variant, we will see it here. Because this is anabolic, means that can try to construct the synthesis of glucose. So which is an anabolism. And if you see this particular pathway is an example for gluconeogenesis with respect to humans. So what is the function of gluconeogenesis? The gluconeogenesis is to be create new glucose molecule from non-carbohydrate sources. So that is called gluconeogenesis. So which is operated in animals and humans. So the glyoxylate cycle, which is same equivalent to the gluconeogenesis, this can be operated in plants and certain microorganisms. And if you see this glyoxylate cycle, which is the major significant in the germination seeds. So why it is to be on germination seeds? Because the germination seeds, there is no green material that is available. So there is no photosynthesis during the germination. It has to require the energy. That energy, the seed part, if you see the seed part is stored, stored fat can be present. That is with the white part. And this stored fat can be hydrolyzed, and that can be converted into sucrose, and finally this can be going to generate the ATP, generate the cellular energy, so that the initial level of seed germination can start. Right. So this is the major significance in the seedlings. And you can see this glyoxylate cycle, which I explained in the previous slides, this can be exclusively operated within the glyoxysomes. These glyoxysomes are membrane bound organelles that are present in plants, even certain microorganisms. You can see here, this is the electronic micrographic image. So the glyoxysomes as well as the mitochondria, these both organelles are to be very close so that the cycle is to be operated with a coordination manner. Because the citric acid cycle, as you remember, this can be operated in the mitochondria. So the product which is formed from the glyoxylate cycle that has to be entered into the mitochondria, where it is to be involved for the production of glucose molecule. Right, clear? This part anyway, we will discuss when going to the coming slide, that is regulation with the citric acid cycle. And if you see a few basic character of this glyoxysome, this is discovered by the Harry Beavers and Breidenbach. These are the two scientists, they discovered this glyoxysomes in plants, and these are specialized peroxisomes. So this is nothing but, this is like in peroxisomes, but somehow it is to be variant of peroxisomes. So they have the single membrane structures, if you see their structure. And if you come to the significance of glyoxysomes, the significance is the beta oxidation pathway. When the fats are hydrolyzing, or the fats are converting into acetyl molecules, two carbon acetyl molecules, the process we call beta oxidation. That anyway, we will going to discuss in the coming classes in detailed manner, how the beta oxidation is to be happening, what are the different steps and enzymes which will be present. So here all the enzymes which are related with the beta oxidation, that can be present in the lysosomes. That is the first significance. And also function in photorespiration and nitrogen fixation in root nodules. This is also be one of the significance of this glyoxylate cycle, significance of this glyoxosomes. And if you see the glyoxosome matrix, that is finely granular, because where you can find the many fat molecule which is to be degrading, so that is hydrolyzing. It's clear? So this is related with the glyoxosomes. Now actually we will discuss about the actual glyoxylate cycle. So this actual glyoxylate cycle, which is a very simple cycle when compared to the Krebs cycle. So here I am trying to give you in a very simple manner, I'll try to explain it, and students, it's better to remember this cycle, because this is some of the important metabolic pathways of plants and microorganisms. So here I'll take the annotations. Better, right? So as I explained that, first suppose if you think this is to be glyoxosomes, fine. This is to be glyoxosome, where the lipids is stored. So the stored lipids, we call it as triacyl glycerols. This triacyl glycerols can be hydrolyzed, and that can be formed the fatty acids. These fatty acids will be converted into acetyl CoA. That is, the process is called beta oxidation. This is acetyl CoA. So once triacyl glycerol is hydrolyzed, and that will converted into fatty acids, and these fatty acids are going to the beta oxidation pathway, where exactly it can generate the two carbon compound, that is acetyl coenzyme A. Clear? So this acetyl coenzyme A will combine with the oxaloacetate with the presence of citrate synthase. These two molecules, acetyl-CoA is two carbon molecule, and the oxaloacetate is to be four carbon molecules. These two molecules are condensed, and together will form a compound, that is citrate, with the presence of citrate synthase. It's clear? This is same like citric acid cycle, that is Krebs cycle. And this citrate is again converting into the isocitrate with the short span intermediate of cis aconitate. So this conversion, all this conversion should require the enzyme, that is aconitase. This you should remember. Right, initially the oxaloacetate is combined with this acetyl-CoA. This acetyl-CoA is coming from the fatty acid because of beta oxidation process. So after this acetyl-CoA oxaloacetate condensation, it can form the citrate, and citrate that can be converted into isocitrate with the presence of enzyme aconitase. It's clear? Now, you think that this isocitrate is a branching point for the two pathways, whether it has to go into the glyoxylate cycle or whether it can be going into the citric acid cycle. So this particular isocitrate, we call this is a branching point, where exactly we will discuss about only glyoxylate cycle. So here this isocitrate is to be converted into glyoxylate as well as succinate. You should remember this. So isocitrate, instead of going into the citric acid cycle, that is beta keto glutarate, it can be going into form the glyoxylate and succinate. This can be with the presence of the enzyme, that is isocitrate lyase, which is a key regulatory of this particular pathway. Isocitrate lyase will work on this isocitrate, and that can convert into glyoxylate as well as succinate. This you should remember. And this glyoxylate will come to the succinate later, and this glyoxylate, which is again converted into the malate, this can be with the presence of enzyme, that is malate synthase. So first, initially isocitrate is converted into glyoxylate and succinate. This one product of glyoxylate, which can be converted into malate, with the help of malate synthase. Here exactly one more molecule of acetyl CoA, one more molecule of acetic acid is to be added. So you should remember that one more acetic acid, this is two carbon source, and this is also be two carbon, total four carbons. These four carbons are released like in a form of succinate. Succinate is called four carbon compounds. This malate is again converting into the oxaloacetate, and that oxaloacetate is regenerated and which is ready for taking of again acetyl CoA from this beta oxidation of fatty acids, and it can again the pathway is continued. Clear? So now if you see here, these two enzymes, isocitrate lyase and malate synthase, these are the two enzymes which are exclusive to the glyoxylate cycle, and these two enzymes are absent in vertebrates. Clear? Right. So the one product, the glyoxylate, which is again involving for the generation of oxaloacetate, that is fine. So we will see the fate of succinate. This succinate, which is produced in the glyoxysomes, that are transported into the mitochondria. So on mitochondria, the succinate is to be involved for the conversion of malate, or this can be involved for the, because of few reactions, but anyway, that I am not going to be discussed. The succinate is to be converted into the malate in the mitochondria. So the succinate has to be transported in the mitochondria, and the malate is again converted into oxaloacetate. Why this is? Because if you see the citric acid cycle can be present in a mitochondria. So the succinate, which is transported into mitochondria, the succinate is again converted into fumarate, malate, from malate to oxaloacetate. So from oxaloacetate, which is converting into the hexose, so oxaloacetate, which can be converted into phosphoenol pyruvate, right? So this we discussed the previous class, that is gluconeogenesis, this phosphoenol pyruvate. That the conversion should require enzyme, the carboxykinase, phosphoenol pyruvate. Carboxykinase is an enzyme that can convert this oxaloacetate into phosphoenol pyruvate. From where exactly? Through the process of gluconeogenesis, the sucrose is manufactured. Right? Again, that can be that can be hydrolyzed to form the monosaccharides, two monosaccharides, and that are involved for the Krebs cycle, for the energy giving pathway. It's clear? So you should remember that here, because of two enzymes, the glyoxylate cycle is to be operated. These two enzymes are not present in humans, even vertebrates. So those two enzymes are isocitrate lyase and malate synthase. Among these two enzymes, isocitrate lyase is the regulatory enzyme for this particular pathway. And if you see this particular pathway is to be bypassed two reactions of the citric acid cycle, this one and this one. So these two reactions are bypassed by this glyoxylate cycle, and this two reactions, if you observe, there will be releasing of one molecule of carbon, that is in form of CO2. You can see here two molecules of carbon is to be released as form of CO2. Instead of releasing two carbon molecules, and that can be involved for the generation of this succinate. This is exactly for the conversion into the phosphoenol pyruvate with the help of the PepsiK, phosphoenol pyruvate carboxykinase enzyme. Clear? Then. So coming to the regulation of this glyoxylate cycle with the citric acid cycle, this is important. So here you should understand the process, because this isocitrate, as I explained, this is to be, we call it as branching point. This is a branching point for the glyoxylate cycle as well as citric acid cycle. This glyoxylate, first suppose we will see from this citric acid cycle, this isocitrate is to be converting into alpha ketoglutarate with the presence of enzyme, that is isocitrate dehydrogenase. This is Krebs cycle, right? this part is to be Krebs cycle. So this conversion, isocitrate to alpha keto glutarate, the conversion should require enzyme that is dehydrogenase, isocitrate dehydrogenase. This isocitrate dehydrogenase, which is inhibited by the enzyme that is protein kinase, you can see here. The protein kinase is an enzyme that can work on the isocitrate dehydrogenase, and it is trying to compromise its activity so that there is no formation of alpha keto glutarate. So if this process is not is going this citric acid cycle pathway, definitely this product is accumulating. And if this product is accumulating, then there is an indication for the isocitrate lyase, which is an regulating enzyme of glyoxylate cycle. So that can taking this isocitrate into the glyoxylate cycle. And if you see, not only the protein kinase, there are few intermediates of citric acid cycle and glycolysis, AMP and ADP. These are all will also act as an inhibitors for this particular enzyme. Right? So you should be remember this, how it can be operated. So for suppose if you take a cell, the particular cell, it is rich with the energy source. The particular cell is having more amount of ATPs, so that the cell, it does not require the ATP. So that in that particular pathway, what is happening? So ATP is more, then definitely it can tell the protein kinase that you try to stop this activity because I'm having enough number of ATP. So that the isocitrate is accumulating and that is going into glyoxylate cycle. In other scenario, if the cell is lacking of energy sources, that is ATP. So this phosphatase enzyme, you can see here, this is the phosphatase enzyme, which is go and tells to this particular dehydrogenase enzyme that you have to work on the Krebs cycle so that the cell needs the more amount of ATP, so you can prepare and give it to the cell. So that's what the phosphatase enzyme is acting as an activator of this particular isocitrate dehydrogenase. It's clear? And even you can see the isocitrate lyase, which is in a glyoxylate cycle, where these are act as an inhibitors for this particular enzyme, like citric acid cycle inhibitors. Because if the citric acid cycle is activating me, what does it mean? The cell require energy. If the cell required energy, mean definitely the glyoxylate cycle has to be shut down. So even glycolysis, AMP and ADP, these are the molecules which will act on the inhibitory manner of this isocitrate lyase. If it is to be activating and finally it is going into the form the succinate and the glyoxylate, as we discussed in a previous slide, that is the elaborative discussion, how it is to be taking place. It's clear? So that the glycolysis, so that the glyoxylate cycle as well as citric acid cycle, they are combinedly regulated. If one is activating, other one has to be stop its pathway. So this is how it is to be taking place. And coming to the last slide of this particular discussion is, if you see this isocitrate lyase, in short form, it can also be called as ICL. You should remember this, ICL is nothing but isocitrate lyase. This isocitrate lyase will have a major role in many pathogenic microorganisms, right? Example here I have given in a mycobacterium, this isocitrate lyase is to be involved in the pathogenesis of the mycobacterium. So definitely there is definitely we think this particular enzyme is a best target for anti-tuberculosis drugs. And if you take certain fungal organisms like Greevy's and rice blast pathogen, this particular fungal organisms, this isocitrate lyase will be involved for the virulence. This you should remember. So this virulence of the fungal organisms is also be involved for the this isocitrate lyase according to the recent reports. And this isocitrate lyase plays an important role in the virulence of Candida albicans, Salmonella species. So altogether, you should remember that in majority of the pathogenic microorganisms, whether it can be fungi or it can be in other microorganisms, this particular isocitrate lyase is to be involved in a pathogenesis. So it can confer the pathogenic nature of that particular enzyme, that particular bacteria or fungus. So there definitely these particular enzyme is to be an direct target for the controlling of various kinds of these diseases to the humans. So friends, this is all about the glyoxylate cycle. I hope I covered everything, and we will meet you in the next class. See you. Bye.